The date is September 18, 2001, and the United States has just suffered the most devastating attack against it since Pearl Harbor. All anyone can think of is the threat of yet another terror attack, and suddenly it becomes very clear that no one anywhere is safe from an attack. But in the busy mailroom of the New York Post, terrorists are the furthest thing from the mind of an overworked mailroom employee trying to sort out the glut of incoming mail. As the employee is busy handling dozens of letters, suddenly, the corner of one works loose, and a fine mist of white powder puffs out of the envelope. Perplexed, the employee opens the envelope and discovers more white powder, along with a printed letter that reads 9/11/01. This is next. Take penicillin now. Death to America. Death to Israel. Allah is great. Hello and welcome to another episode of the Infographics Show. Today, we're remembering the anthrax letter attacks in the United States as we take a look at just how dangerous is an anthrax letter. 1 week after the September 11th terror attacks, several letters were sent via post to various media offices and political figures. Inside each letter was a printed-out note that read much like a terrorist threat, along with powder laced with anthrax spores. By the time the letter stopped arriving, 5 people would be dead and 17 others hospitalized in serious condition. While it is suspected that a biodefense worker from the United States government itself was to blame for the attacks, no definite conclusion would ever be reached, as the suspect Bruce Edward Ivins would go on to commit suicide. In the end, the cost of cleaning up and decontaminating worksites and entire post offices would reach a whopping $1 billion, which leads us to ask, just how dangerous is an anthrax letter, really? But first, what is anthrax? Anthrax is a highly infectious disease that's caused by a naturally occurring bacteria called Bacillus anthracis. This bacteria typically lives in the soil and often infects wild and domestic animals such as goats, cattle, and sheep. Surprisingly, anthrax outbreaks are pretty common around the world and mostly affect agricultural workers who spend all day around animals or working with the dirt. Those who process animal goods such as hides, wool, or bones can also become infected, however. The bacteria can infect a host in 3 different ways, with the first being the most common and resulting in cutaneous anthrax, or an infection that occurs by bacteria spores entering the body through a cut or scrape on the skin. This is actually a very easy form of the disease to treat and can be easily cured with simple antibiotics. When inhaled, however, anthrax becomes far deadlier, and those who become infected via inhalation are at dire risk of respiratory collapse. This form of the disease has the highest rate of death, with a 92% mortality rate. The third form of the disease occurs when the anthrax spores are actually consumed, as can happen when you eat the meat of an infected animal. This form of infection is extremely rare, but can also be quite deadly. In the United States, between 20 and 60% of all gastrointestinal anthrax cases result in death. Anthrax bacteria are very long-lived, and their spores can remain dormant for years in the soil. Upon entering a living host, the spores reactivate, and the bacteria begins to multiply. Because of its natural resiliency and extremely long life, anthrax is a natural choice for bioweapons, and 5 nations, including Russia and the United States, maintain anthrax as a bioweapon ready for deployment. Today, anthrax bioweapons are used as deterrents, meant to discourage the other side from using bioweapons in the first place. But that was not always the case. In the First World War, Scandinavian nations used anthrax against the Imperial Russian Army, and the Germans covertly infected livestock and feed from neutral nations that were being shipped to Allied nations. One attack resulted in the deaths of 200 Argentinian mules. After the many chemical and biological horrors of World War I, though, an international diplomatic effort was made to limit the use of bio and chemical weapons, resulting in the Geneva Protocol for the Prevention of Use in War of Asphyxiating Poisonous or Gases and Bacteriological Methods of Warfare. While a great step forward, the treaty did not outlaw the research or production of biological agents, and nations around the world signed onto the treaty but created amendments that would allow them to use biological weapons as retaliation. In World War II, the British Army would deploy small quantities of anthrax against German livestock in an attempt to help starve the Germans, though thankfully anthrax as a weapon would not rear its ugly head again until 1993, when a religious cult in Japan deployed anthrax against civilians in Tokyo. Over the course of several days, the doomsday cult Om Shinrikyo secretly released an aerosol liquid suspension of anthrax from the top of their 8-story building. On the first day, local residents reported foul odors to local environmental health authorities, who quickly discovered the odor to be coming from the Om Shinrikyo building. The next day, even more reports of foul odors were logged, along with symptoms ranging from appetite loss to nausea and vomiting in some of the affected personnel. Due to the complaints, officials requested permission to investigate the building, but Om Shinrikyo members inside refused to allow them inside. Because of no readily apparent risk to human health, authorities were powerless to do anything else but simply collect samples for future analysis. The next day, an intermittent mist began escaping from one of the cooling towers atop the building, and though again officials took samples of the oily residue left on the sides of the building, nothing more was done. It wouldn't be until 2 years later, after the March 1995 sarin gas attack in the Tokyo subway, that officials went back and tested the samples, discovering that the group had been trying to aerosolize a liquid suspension of anthrax spores. Obviously, their plan hadn't done more than make some people mildly ill, but had it worked, they could have potentially killed hundreds or far more. For their part, the Doomsday Cult believed that the ensuing pandemic would have triggered a global war, which would have ended with the group's leader ruling the world. That seems like a pretty big jump, but dream big, we guess. So on one hand, anthrax was used to try and start a third world war, yet failed to make anyone anything more than just mildly nauseous. On the other, though small amounts of white powder led to the death of 5 individuals and almost 24 seriously ill, just how dangerous is anthrax really then? And specifically, how dangerous is an anthrax letter? Well, as with most things, the quality of the sample used in the anthrax matters a great deal, as does the technical proficiency behind the dispersal method. Anthrax is surprisingly easy to cultivate at home and requires no more than about $2,500 of easily bought laboratory equipment to start your own bioterror weapons program. Anthrax is also very easily acquired from the soil of just about any agricultural area, so getting a base sample is not really difficult. However, some strains of the bacteria are better than others, and while the Japanese doomsday cult Om Shinrikyo was in effect running an amateur-level anthrax weapons program, the suspect behind the American letter attacks was a former U.S. biodefense employee and would have had access to very high-quality spore samples. At the very least, he would have had the means and the education to create his own from a wild sample. The aerosol attack didn't work for a variety of reasons, primarily because the investigators didn't believe that the Doomsday group had perfected the process enough, and it had ended up killing most of the spores. However, the concentrated powder that those on the receiving end of the anthrax letters found themselves covered in would have been an extremely optimal delivery method. When you're holding a letter, you're typically doing so in very close proximity to your nose and mouth, and given anthrax's microscopic size, it wouldn't take much to get even just a few hundred spores out of millions into your respiratory tract. Any powder that spilled onto your hands would quickly spread across your skin and then into your clothes, where it could be dragged onto other areas of your skin. At that point, even the tiniest cut or puncture in your skin would lead to an infection. In short, anthrax letters remain a serious threat, and depending on just how close you stick your face to your mail, could lead to certain death. With the last attack costing a total cleanup cost of $1 billion, anthrax is a threat that the US government takes very seriously. So if you're looking to join in with the other jokesters who sent prank anthrax letters full of talcum powder after the original attacks, we recommend you don't, before you find yourself in prison for making deadly threats.